When I wrote my book Given, I had a lot of different poems that I'd written throughout the years, and I tried to chain link them in some way in order to connect their meanings and ideas. So I ended up breaking my book Given into chapters. And the first chapter is called Nature. I'm going to read a few poems from Nature. The prettiest thing that I have seen, the prettiest thing I know, is the sun shining in the sky above freshly fallen snow. And then the first poem of this chapter is called Of Spring and Fall. The first day of sweetened spring, when flowers bloom and dewdrops cling to weakened stems of youthful kings, and early birds begin to sing. The sun appears from long ago, rising forth from depths below, when nature's movement seems so slow, and water escapes from melting snow. Rivers sprout from mountain streams, built with love and laced with dreams, giving hope to new life schemes, held together by golden seams. The river flows into the fall when royal leaves answer the call to leave the branches that gave them all upon an ancient leaf-strewn wall. And into darkness, nature stares, knowing death and cold despair of forgotten stories it meant to share, and impossible tasks it meant to dare. Of life and death, we all must face a new flavor we are forced to taste, a new journey to a different place. Our past is perfect, we shall never erase. My next poem in this chapter is Nothing Green Can Stay, and it was a response to Robert Frost's poem Nothing Gold Can Stay. And I use the same rhyme scheme and length, and it's really a counter proposal. Nothing green can stay. Oh, it is such parting sorrow when the fall comes with the morrow, when the summer weakly fades and leaves succumb to autumn shades. The leaves cling to aging limbs, but only as the summer dims, for it is when no branch can hold that nature's first green is gold. The third poem of my chapter, Nature, is called The Desert Flower, and I was inspired to write this by the super blooms in the California deserts, particularly the Death Valley, which every decade or so will have this just magnificent super bloom, and you wonder how. But sometimes also there's just a single flower in the desert, and this poem is about that. And I wrote it because my mom reminded me of a desert flower who was struggling and thriving and still beautiful, even in the deserts of despair and the heat of heartbreak. So the desert flower. The desert flower stands alone amid a sea of dirt and dust. It never cowers, though one is prone to fall into a trance of lust. It stands alone above the dirt and lifts its petals to the sky. It shades the stones despite its hurt, but never stops to question why. And amid the barren sea of rock and dirt and dust and arid sand, one can see this flower mock the dangers of this foreign land. And one last poem. I'm skipping a few, but this poem is special to me for a lot of reasons, but the name especially is kind of a drawback to my hometown, Claremont, and it's from Latin for clarity. This poem is called Clarimus. Nary once a tempest rose, nary once indeed, above the road called Clarimus, a traveler sign did read. Nary once did rain dare fall, nary a storm dare blew, above the road named Clarimus, where skies were always blue. Nary once did lightning strike, nary a bolt did I see. For on stormy days, I would sit inside and imagine this place far from me.